topic. So the application agenda item main is seeking planning permission for 38 dwellings plus associated works at land east of Windmill Fields on Warhol Road in Harlow. Just draw members' attention, please, to the update sheet that was circulated and also the comments received from Essex County Council. The circulators have been yesterday. So the application is before committee today because the officer recommendation of approval is contrary to five objections that were received from local residents, which are detailed in the report. Councillor considered those but believed that the benefits of the scheme, the policy compliance, nature of the application and the delivery of housing outweighs those harm, and the application is recommended for approval subject to the conditions and the legal agreements. So the application site is on the screen. Edged in red, it amounts to 1.8 hectares. It's located to the east of Harlow and it's forming part of the wider HS3 allocation that seeks an allocate to deliver 2,600 houses. And you can just see the aerial image. And just draw attention here, this is the Windmill Fields, where we've had some concern from residents with regards to impact on residential amenity. This is an aerial image of the site, actually where you've got Warhol Road, where the vehicular access is coming from here, and again, just referring back to the rear gardens of these properties in Windmill Fields, and noting the relative good depth of a lot of those gardens increase as you go up the site. Just in terms of the wider context, so you've got the site edged in red, Warhol Road to the north. You can just see the A414 Old Harlow and just see its relationship to Gilman Park and the built-up area. These fields around here are what's included within the allocation on the policy HS3. And I've got a slide of that allocation shortly. Okay, this is a context plan and this shows the site in relation to key services. These isochromes here, these are the distances, the walking distances from the site. So you've got a 5 minute, 10 minute and 15 minutes. So you can see the key here was school, supermarkets, you've got Harlow Mill Station, and you can see that the walking routes and the relative distances. Just a close up, and this is in relationship of the site to transport modes. So you can see you've got two bus routes in relative close vicinity to site that take any future resident into Harlow Town Centre, and you've got the relative distances by cycling and bus. It shows the connectivity. So these photos are taken from the design and access statement. They just show the surrounding area, some of the photos in the context of the surrounding area. And again, some further photos from slightly further away. It's sort of like an old Harlow. So just in terms of some of the observational opportunities, I say this has been brought up and this is coming from the design and access statement submitted with the application. So it is part of a allocated strategic housing site, what was allocated in the local plan in December 2020. It's in flood zone 1, which is the lowest area of susceptible to flooding. You've got the Stanson Flight Path, 3.5 kilometres to the north. You've got the neighbouring properties, which has obviously been considered in terms of the layout of the scheme. You've got some mature trees and hedgerows, and then you've got the opportunities that they've brought up. Turning to the proposed layout, say 38 dwellings proposed. That amounts to a density of 21.6 dwellings per hectare, which is not inconsistent with the wider Harlow area and considered to be an acceptable density of development in this location. You've got 12 homes affordable, with the balance of 26 being with market sale, 62 allocated parking spaces, and those are all provided on plot plus a further 6 visitor spaces. All those parking spaces for the all the spaces will have active EV charging points. You've got 4,252 square metres of landscape public open space plus 4,200 of private metres of space as well. So it's also a landscape-led scheme as well as delivering the housing. Just turning to some of the sections through the site. So the top one is looking easterly direction, and the bottom section is looking towards the west, and this is the boundary of the side of Windmill Terrace, I think it feels to the further to the west. And just some of the elevations of the properties. So these are all being planned back, but there's a common theme emerging through the design of the dwellings to ensure that there is cohesion amongst the scheme. And some illustrative views. So the key considerations are as listed in the report, members. I'll just run through these, so it is detailed in the report, but I'll just run through some key headlines. As I noted, the site forms part of the wider HS3 allocation, so it is a development plan-led proposal, and it falls approximately 0.14 for total allocation of 38 dwellings at density of 21. The scheme does secure future connectivity into the wider allocation, so that's been factored into the design and layout. There's currently consultation which has been undertaken on the East of Harlow Master Plan SPD. That's had due regard, the applicants have had due regard to that as it's gone through the process, and we consider the scheme in accordance with that wider elements considered within that document. And the proposal, therefore, in principle, is considered acceptable subject to the detailed elements. And just this is the policy that I'm sure you know. So the application site is in the top northwest small portion, obviously closest to the existing residential urban form, and you can see the balance of the HS3 allocation sweeping round to the junction of the M11. In terms of the layout, all the houses have got private gardens, and they've all been designed to ensure privacy and avoid any overlooking. And I'll come on to the residential amenity with the neighbouring properties, but you can just see the decent garden widths of the proposed dwellings and the existing dwellings. Parking is in accordance with Essex County Council standards. The parking's on plot, which is preferable to parking courts in terms of secure by design and layout and access to those properties. And it takes account of a number of the constraints, such as requirement for the sus attenuation pond in the northwest corner of this location, and the connectivity in terms of the wider site. And you'll note in your report that comments have been received from the council's design colleague, who considers it to be well designed, layout, and a good design of scheme. So there's no objections from a council's design perspective. This is a plan just showing the massing. So the majority of the dwellings are two-storey. You've got five properties at 2.5-storey at key points within the scheme, and that just creates some visual breaks within the terraces. And the northern part of the site benefits from screening from the tree belt to the north here. That's the housing mix that I referred to earlier, so in terms of it's four bedroom dwellings at 2.5-storey, all the rest are in 2-storey. That plan just details what the housing mix is. So the blue ones are two bedrooms, the yellow are three bedroom dwellings, the grey and the orange are four bedrooms, and these are five bedroom dwellings. Turning to the housing tenure, so 12 of which are proposed to be affordable, which is in line with our adopted policy in the local plan, policy HA. Three of the homes are provided as first homes, two for shared ownership, and seven for affordable rent in terms of the affordable makeup. And I say the homes are of different tenures are kept deposited throughout the development, obviously designed to be tenure blind. So there isn't that distinction between the affordable and the market dwellings. In terms of the inclusivity of the dwellings, 10% will be designed to meet requirements of N4, which are wheelchair adaptable dwellings, and 15% of the affordable dwellings designed to meet those requirements. All the homes are designed to approve document part M42. The footways and the accesses will all allow inclusive access throughout the site, and level access will be provided to all the communal entrances and to the entrance of all houses as well as the rear gardens. So it's in terms of design, it's future-proofing those homes. So this is a highways improvement plan that has been brought forward. So what you will see is a change at this point to a 30 mile an hour zone on Warhol Road, and you've got traffic calming measure in this location here just as you access the eastern part of the site, and this is the main entrance into the site, and then you've got a new footway to link in to Windmill Fields to improve that connectivity from the entrance of the site and through the site to the remainder of Old Harlow. So this is the access plan, so you can see that's the main access in into the site, and you've got those connectivity links to future-proof the scheme in relation to the wider HS3 allocation. And then you've got a dedicated cycle and pedestrian route as well. So this is the connectivity, so you've got the primary spine route, as I say, you've got these cycle links and pedestrian links through in these locations here. The services are all designed to be shared, services child-friendly. Pedestrians and cyclists being prioritised through the scheme. So in terms of highways, it's considered acceptable from a highways perspective and offers that good circulation space within the scheme. 62 allocated car parking spaces, and you've got the visitor spaces too. So as I said earlier, they will have EV charging points. The parking requirement meets Essex County Council standards. You've also got the additional cycle parking for the properties, one space per dwelling plus 5 visitor spaces. And you can see the visitor spaces are the purple spaces. The green is the cycle parking, but you can't probably see them, so in the rear gardens for the most part. That's just the parking breakdown. In terms of drainage, the site is in flood zone 1, which has the lowest probability of flooding from Seal River. The sub strategy has been designed, and you'll know in the report that there's no objection from the County Council drainage team. So from a sub and drainage perspective, the application is considered acceptable. Turning to residential medicine, that was raised by some of the local residents, you'll see in the committee papers. So the agents have marked up these plans to show the back-to-back distances, which in the closest of properties to Windmill Fields actually exceeds the requirements laid out in the Essex Design Guide, Supplementary Planning Guides, and which is there designed to respect overlooking and residential amenities. So from that point, whilst there will be a change of outlook of some of those properties, that isn't a planning consideration, but what the scheme does do is seek to ensure that there's no direct overlooking to a level significant enough to make the development unacceptable. And that in turn follows within the site as well in terms of the new dwellings and how they're positioned in relation to each other. And this is the waste management plan. So with the exception of the northern spine route, where there will be a bin presentation point because of the lack of ability for a refuse vehicle to turn, and you won't want them going backwards and reversing out. Refuse vehicles can manoeuvre within the site and pick up bins on collection day. So in terms of the summary, the proposal is considered to be policy compliant, the course of policy HS3 of the local plan. It will secure early to every part of the wider allocation, delivering much needed market and affordable housing, which helps meet the district's housing requirement. The scheme is considered well designed in terms of the layout and the physical appearance of the building, and responds positively to the wider area, and also secures that wider connectivity to the allocation when it comes forward. There's no technical objections, and there's suitable contributions proposed that are included within your report to mitigate the impact of the development. And the application therefore recommended for approval subject to the section 106 and the conditions as listed in your report. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much for that comprehensive introduction to this item. We now go to comments from members of the public who registered, starting with those against, and we have Ms. Yasmin Gregory. If I could invite you to come forward to the microphone that's pulled forward in the middle there, please. And this one just here, pulled forward, yeah. And then once I turn my microphone off, if you can turn yours on, you have 3 minutes to make the presentation to the committee.
Good evening. My name is Jasmine Gregory. I'm here on behalf of the Green Party, and I've had comments given to me by residents. Thank you very much for the explanation of the application. Now, I was trying to just flick through quickly to keep it all in context. But once again, what we have here, we start off, we've got 38 houses. And then before you know it, we've got another 2,800. And the roads cannot cope as it is. I notice we have some flood zone one, and you say that the flood zone, it's acceptable. So another word for acceptable is adequate. Now I think the people who are living in Churchgate Street, they would question about the flooding because they were affected severely with the flooding last year. It might be only in the church. My memory's not certainly right on that one. So I would question that, and I would question the data that's been brought in. I would question the data that's been brought in about flooding, because since we had since Junction 7A was built, the data that we've requested has been slightly deviated from what had been available beforehand. I think the other thing as well that we need to look at, it's commendable that we've got the cycling space. You've got one cycling space in a garden storage area. That is not adequate. If you've got family cycling, you're encouraging cycling, you're going to need far more space. So I think it's not been thought through terribly well. You say about parking for the visitors, and there's adequate parking, I use the word adequate again, parking for two cars. We have a problem in Harlow, I'm not sure if you're aware, of cars parking on pavements. We have far too many cars. And I think that there's going to be an increase of traffic, and this is what this resident was saying to me. They are concerned about the traffic coming through, the traffic that's being used in the wrap run already. With regard to the change of outlook with the residents of Windmill Fields, yeah, there is a change of outlook. They won't be looking across fields anymore. And we have this with the problem at the Oxleys, where I know that the consortium has been problematic. I would ask that consideration be given before this is granted. I think that we need to stop. I think we need to think about what we are granting, because we are opening up a can of worms.
Thank you, Ms. Ferrer. Can you turn the microphone off, please?
Oh, it's off already. Okay.
Thank you very much. We now go to any speakers for the application, and there are none. And so then we move to comments from the applicant or agent, and we have Mr. Tim Childress. I hope I've pronounced that correctly. You have 3 minutes, sir.
Chair and councillors, thank you for your time and for allowing me to address your committee this evening. I'd also like to thank Ms. Bates for a report and detailed presentation tonight. My name is Tim Childers and I'm a director at Anderson. We are an Essex-based construction business with a directly employed workforce, 36 of whom actually live in the Harlow area. As a local builder and not a speculative promoter, we first got involved in this project when a large house builder decided that it was too small for them and not worth their continued effort. But at our scale of operation, reputation means everything to us, and it is for this reason that we want to showcase what we can do through this development with proper craftsmanship, good materials, and thoughtful design and detailing. At the heart of this vision for the scheme is the brilliant relationship we have formed with our landowners. They are as dedicated as we are to bringing forward a scheme of real quality, creating a legacy for this parcel of land which has been in their family for generations. For over 4 years, therefore, we've been working with our landowners and with your officers to come up with a scheme that is truly exceptional and sets a benchmark for development in this area. We believe that our trusted architects have interpreted what all the stakeholders have asked of us, making the best use of this land to deliver 3 first homes alongside the 9 affordable homes and 26 private homes, all of which are suited to family living. We do know that new development is always contentious and can be very disconcerting for the existing population. So we've designed a scheme which respects people's lives and livelihoods, and we of course undertake to cause the least disruption possible during any build phase itself. This application is incredibly important to us. We understand fully the responsibility that will be placed on us in your granting permission tonight. We do have the workforce, the supply chain, and also the funding in place to get on and deliver this scheme. And with your agreement, we look forward to demonstrating our capability in an area that you know well. Thank you again for your time.
Thank you very much for that. We now move on to questions from councillors and any clarifications that they may have. I've seen Councillor Leppold's hand first.
Thank you, Chair. This is a point of clarification. On page 21, it refers to, and it shows a breakdown of the Section 106 contributions, which, off the top of my head, excluding the monitoring fee per obligation, comes out at about £489,000. On the amended agenda, or supplementary one, item B, it talks about a suitable financial contribution of circa £400,000 towards the enhancement of walking and cycling provision. I understand from the breakdown of the first part and the second one, which only seems to be on the supplementary paper, that these are two distinct contributions. Is that correct? So the total contribution would be somewhere towards over 800,000.
Just that. Thank you. Turn your microphone off if you want an answer.
Thank you for your share. Yes, that's correct. So, and they're the requests that have come from Essex County Council and the other providers of those services in terms of, and they provide that evidence to underpin those calculations.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody else got questions? Councillor Kane Morris.
Thank you. Thanks very much. I have a couple of questions. Well, it's just 2 because Councillor Leopard has already asked one of them. I'm curious. We've been told this evening, and it's in the papers anyway, that this site was allocated in the local plan which was adopted in 2020. So I wonder why, given how desperately needed housing is at the moment, why has it taken so long, relatively speaking, to arrive here? Shall I ask the other questions? Well, sorry about the croak. I think everybody's croaking at the moment. And the other question concerns energy efficiency measures. We have charging points, which is excellent, in each of the parking spaces. Are there other measures attached to the house, solar panels, insulation, heat pumps, because on a previous occasion we had agreed or certainly committed ourselves to a desire to introduce more 21st century save the planet type measures.
Who would like to pick up which one?
Through you,
Chair, if I do the first point, and then I think Mrs. Speaker's going to pick up the second point. I mean, just because the sites are allocated, Council of Russell, as you know, it's not necessarily going to come forward. One of the reasons for the delay on the site is this is part of the much larger East of Harlow strategic master planning site, and you will notice some of the historical comments from our consultees say that it would be potentially premature to bring this site forward in isolation before the rest of the larger site, because in good planning you would ideally do all your planning at once. So that's one reason for the delay. The reason it's coming forward now is that the time has moved on. We now have master planning principles approved for the site. They have gone through a very wide consultation process, including a public meeting with the residents of Churchgate Street, which was very well attended, and they will be approved hopefully by the Garden Town Board in May as a kind of final endorsement. And the developers of this particular 38 unit part of the site have followed those master planning principles, taken those on board, and a big part of their section 106 contributions, the vast majority of which are for infrastructure, linkages, walking, footpath, cycling, taken into account the fact that they are the first part of that much larger strategic site and will indeed, you know, pump prime that, bring it forward. There are also a high level of contributions through the section 106, including the over policy delivery of affordable housing. And another, you know, major issue for bringing it forward now is we believe that master planning developers for the whole site are about to be approved. And when they come forward to negotiate their 106, the fact that this particular developer is exceeding policy requirements in terms of infrastructure, we believe will set the standard that we will expect other developers to follow. So the delay is largely around the master plan, also the climate, COVID, everything else. But the reason it's coming forward now is things can go from being premature, then as time moves on, it's no longer premature, and we believe it's the right time, and we've sought legal advice around that, to bring the site forward now as the first part of this very important site for Harlow. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. Very quickly, on the sustainability, so the scheme achieves net zero energy status, so that goes above and beyond our policy requirement and building regulation, so it's a very good design in terms of the energy and sustainability credentials.
Jim, can you give me a bit more detail?
There's a report that underpins it, but there was too much to put in the report, but I can, you know, it will be conditioned, that document, and it does go way above our policy requirements, so it's a very good design in terms of its energy efficiency.
Okay, any other questions or clarifications from members? That's the whole room.
Thank you, Chair. On page 19, you've got two allocated town park spaces for every three bedrooms going in and above, but you're not talking about the two-bed parking. What about that side of things? Aren't they going to get parking under the three-bed? Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. I'll hand over to the officer, I think, to bring up the map that was part of the presentation.
So there's two allocated parking spaces for three bedroom and above. Yeah, but there's parking for every dwelling, so the two bedrooms will have one parking. Will have one parking space, yes.
Councillor Burse.
Just some clarification. You talked about the depth of the gardens, because there's obviously the residents have raised it being overlooked. Could you clarify the depths of the gardens? Have you got that?
So in terms of, these are the closest points, the closest properties, so that distance there to the back of that property, that's 32.4 metres. The one below is 34.3, I think that's 3. So the guidance in the Essex SPD is 25 metres, so these significantly exceed that in terms of respect to privacy.
wildlife, what evidence have there as any loss of wildlife?
You've got a significant unknown. I'll go back to the aerial. Bear with me, several slides. So this is the aerial of the site. You can just see the tree belt to the north that for the most part will be retained, with the exception of some cutting back to improve the visibility on Warhol Road. It isn't what you would consider to be a significant wildlife habitat on there, and obviously the loss of that was considered through the allocation in the local plan as well. But what you've also got in the scheme, I think it was one of the earlier slides, a significant amount of open space, both public and garden space, so it does deliver some better quality open space within the scheme than currently exists at the moment.
Does that cover everything from you, Nicky?
Yeah. Council, let Martin come back. Yes, please. Thank you, Chair. On page 25, this deals with the conditions for any approval. On item 12, it says all units within the development hereby approved shall remain in use as affordable housing in perpetuity. How does that work in practice? Because what happens if somebody says, right, I want to buy this house?
So the intention is to, you know, to retain those as affordable housing, but obviously there is separate legislation relating to the right to buy, and obviously in due course that can't be restricted if someone comes in and requires, but obviously what we're seeking to do is provide the affordable housing to retain and keep.
Thank you.
Okay, councillors, any other questions? Councillor Kane Morrison.
Thank you, Chair. Are we now dealing with conditions?
We're on questions and clarification, so if you want to ask a question about a condition, then you can do that. If not, I'll leave it up to you to raise something during the debate when we get there.
I think we're nearly there.
Well, I'm just waiting to see if councillors have any more questions before I move on. No? Okay, in which case we'll go to debate. Councillor Morrison, would you like to kick us off then?
I will, thank you, Chair. I'll kick you off. Condition number two refers to the construction working day. Previously, we had agreed a preference for finish being 6 p.m. In other words, 1,800 hours. So I think we should try to be consistent about that. This is 1830, it says here. And is there a condition about wheel cleaning, street cleaning, etc.? I think I've missed it if it exists. If it's not there, we should certainly include it.
Would you like to tell that?
Yes, thank you for you, Chair. So there is a condition requiring a construction management plan, and that's where those details would be included, but obviously there'll be further details as well within that. So that would be in the construction management plan. In terms of the hours, I mean, that's up to members to consider, but from officers 6:30 isn't an unreasonable time for construction. It's not particularly late in the day, but if members wish to change it, that's at members' discretion. It's not what we consider to be a particularly sensitive site in terms of near schools or dense residential areas, and I think the construction management plan can probably deal with the manoeuvring within the site and respect those properties on Wimble Terrace, because I think they're the closest, but construction traffic is going to come straight into the site through that access of Warhol Road, so there's not the disturbance that you get from a lot of sites in terms of construction.
Thank you for that assistance. Councillor Morrison, do you want to continue entering through the debate?
Yes. It's simply that I prefer consistency, so that when we state a requirement, we maintain that stance. It makes it a lot easier, I think, for everybody, including applicants. So I hope that you will agree to change that so we go back half an hour.
Are you moving that as a proposal on this?
Yes.
you, Chair. I'm pleased that Moorhall Road is going to get reduced in speeding because it's always had been a reference. I'm pleased that there is some traffic calming on there. I think this is a good design. I'm still a bit concerned about the carbon footprint. There's no mention in there about solar panels, which does concern me a little bit, and also about heat pumps. I think we've got to be very careful about how much that we help to get our climate change or our carbon footprint lower.
Thank you, Councillor Souza. Anyone else? In which case, I'll give you my view. I think the majority of the decision on this application rests with the December 2020 Loughborough Plan. This is part of HS3. It's part of the area that was clearly designated by this council, regardless of whether we agreed with it or disagreed with it at the time, as future housing. Those sites were chosen to be the most suitable and least impact. I, like Councillor Souza, am pleased to see the traffic calming measures that have been added. I'm particularly keen on, and I know you've raised some concerns there about the net zero status, but the statement in the report says that the proposed development achieves net zero energy status through design standards that go beyond the expectations of policy and building regulations. And I know as a council we've set some very tough design build standards for sustainability. So if we're going beyond that, I do consider that to be a benefit. I think the arguments of overlooking are not found with 32 metres in over 100 foot distance from building to building. And I think actually looking at the piece of scrubland on the map and on the ground compared to the pictures we've seen of what this would be, I think that might be an improvement to the environment. Personally, I'm happy to vote to support this. I will put it to the vote with the amendment moved by Councillor Morrison to move the timings to 6 p.m. Those in favour? That appears to be unanimous. Thank you very much, and thank you to members of the public and the agent who attended.